This is Broncos Brawl.
President, we need a National Guard.
This one's for Pat! CJ Anderson is going to go all the way, and the Denver Broncos win the game.
Hey, baby, let's keep it rolling. There ain't no reason to stop.
Oh, man, it is so great to finally be able to do Broncos Brawl and have you on here. I'm so excited for the new journey. We've definitely got a lot to talk about, especially today. I mean, really, we're just going to be diving in from here on out all the way up until the draft. We are stacked full with an agenda, you know, discussing anything from free agency to off-season fits, talking about the draft and prospects coming out, a promising class in 2020. But we got to start with recapping the main gist of things, and that is the 2019 season. It didn't end as we wanted, but there's a lot of promise in the future for the Denver Broncos, and we can get right into that, man. How do you feel the 2019 season went for the Broncos?
It went 7-9. It was not good, man. I mean, there's nowhere to paint it. Yeah. I mean, the only thing that, you know, really we came out of it was, you know, finding some under the radar kind of guys. And then really we graduated with Drew Lock at the end.
Yeah. I mean, on paper, it's not nice. It's not pretty at all by any means. But, I mean, 7-9, it's the best record we've had since 2016. And given what we've been in years, the past 2 years, it's on the up. I mean, the outlook is nice. I know it's another year of dread, but Drew Lock, man, talk about him. He's a phenomenal quarterback. He stepped up when we needed him the most. What did you like about Drew Lock?
I like how he pushed the ball downfield. I don't think we've seen that since really Peyton Manning with his, for a lack of better words, his noodle arm, as many DBs would call it. But no, I mean, we saw a lot of, you know, check down, check with me's, a lot of stuff that would go to the running backs and tight ends, which are usually your safety valves. But really, we saw him push the ball downfield, attack the sidelines. That's something we haven't seen since really Peyton Manning.
And, you know, I like to relate a lot of that to college. Of course, I go to the University of Missouri, so I've kind of been around Drew Lock a little longer than most Denver fans. He was a Kansas City, Missouri native, as much as I hate to say it. But out of Lee Summit, he came right in, stepped right up his freshman year, didn't get as many reps, then transitioning into his sophomore year is really when you got to see him. And I could kind of see a comparison from his sophomore year to this year. You know, he stepped up in the final six games of his sophomore year, and they went 6-6 on that season. And they had started out at, I believe, a record of 1-5 when he was at Missouri. I think he lost one game in that final stretch of games, or maybe it was the quarterback before him. But that's when he really showed his leadership and intangibles. And at the end of this season, you definitely saw that. He was able to step up and make plays when we needed him. And that's what you want from your quarterback, obviously. A great leader. So just a phenomenal job.
Speaking of Missouri, thanks for Drew Lock and MPJ here in Denver.
Hey, dude, my pleasure, for real. Because, I mean, I like to think of Denver as my second home. My dad's from the Denver area. So, you know what? There's a connection there. I was blessed to have those guys go to Denver, and I know the future is bright with them.
Very young, too.
Absolutely, absolutely. Well, Drew, on that note, he did finish as the second most passing yards in the SEC at 12,000 yards at the end of his Tiger career. And going back to the deja vu analogy or the whole thing, what really also stood out was the fact that he had played at a pro-style offense and he really utilized his tight ends. And you talked about that. You brought up a good point with utilizing the tight end and the running back. And I give a lot of credit to Derek Dooley, who was the Missouri offensive coordinator that he worked with. He wanted to build around Albert Okwuegbunam, who is going to be coming out in this draft. He's the number one tight end prospect, according to Mel Kiper. And
by the way, I call him Albert O, because I'm not attempting that.
Nah, ESPN, they butcher it. It's Akwe Bunam, whatever. But nonetheless, you know, he made Albert Okwuegbunam his junior year the best tight end in the country. Off of 43 receptions, I believe he recorded, I'm looking at the stat line here, my apologies. Well, nonetheless, he utilized him. And, I mean, it worked out to Missouri's benefit. He only played 9 games in his junior year. He was out for 4 games, and they had to finish off the season without him. But Drew Lock definitely utilized him. And, oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, man.
No, you're good. Go ahead.
I was going to say, so how does that transitioning over to the let me set the stage here. Transitioning over to next year with Noah Fant. Of course, when Drew Lock got on the field, he was able to utilize his tight ends more than you saw with Joe Flacco and more with you than you saw with Brandon Allen. How does that look in the future for Noah Fant and Drew Lock? How do you like that relationship?
I love it. Considering that I would say as far as any position on offense, tight end has got to be one of the hardest positions to take over in the NFL outside of quarterback. Mm-hmm. You're not only learning wide receiver routes, but you're also learning how to block. You know, you're learning hot routes. You're learning check with me's. You're learning, you know, on top of the fact that you're expected to be, you know, a slot receiver, you're also an extended tackle.
Yes. And they ran they ran two tight end sets when he was at Missouri. Albert Okwuegbunam, I just found that stat line. He recorded 43 receptions for 468 yards and 6 touchdowns in his junior year off of just 9 games. And then in Locke's second game, I mean, it was quick to find out that Noah Fant and him would have a heck of a relationship. He had 4 receptions off of 4 targets. That's 4 for 4, and I'm not talking Wendy's meal deal. 113 yards and 1 touchdown. And it was his second best performance behind Cleveland when Fant recorded 3 receptions off of 4 targets and 115 yards, 1 touchdown. So
yeah, I knew,
pretty impressive.
I knew Fant was good. I didn't know he was this good. I didn't know he was going to be outrunning DBs down the sideline. Oh. His hands were something I actually was a little bit questionable on, not because he dropped a lot of passes in college, just because, you know, he was running a lot of seam routes that usually he was wide open on. Just because of Hawkinson, I believe.
Yeah.
Down in Iowa.
Yeah.
So
that's tight end university there. They produce, of course, George Kittle, but you go back to Noah Fant, and that was one of the things about I heard. I mean, when I was out in Nashville, because I did cover the draft when I was out there with my show here in town, Breakfast of Champions airs every Thursday at 9 a.m., but this isn't a promo. But anyway, you what?
Shameless plug.
Anyway, I was able to get in and go over there. But one of the things that I kept hearing about Noah Fant when I was out there was the fact that he was just the speedier of the tight ends. I mean, when the conversation of tight end came up, he's the quickest tight end, really the playmaker, a red zone threat. And if he were to come into to Denver's system, I kind of thought of him as like a Julius Thomas, but just way quicker. As far as his his talent in the red zone or whatever you want to say. But nonetheless, yeah, I think the tight end will be utilized very much so in the upcoming season. So Drew Lock,
I think we saw a lot of bootlegs coming off. You know, it wasn't something that Flacco ran a lot outside of when he had Kubiak in Baltimore.
Yeah.
But we saw a lot more boots when Brandon Allen was in, and then we saw even more bootlegs once Drew Lock came in. Which,
yeah.
I mean, if you look at the disparity in time to throw, it was actually, I think he got an extra, 0.4 seconds, which is huge in the NFL. That's the difference between, you know, 3 reads and 4 reads in the NFL.
I didn't know that. That's pretty crazy. That's a lot of time.
It really is. I mean, the difference between 1 second and 2 seconds just is a blink. I mean, you look at that in the NFL, like I said, that's 2 reads at least. And when you're doing rolling yourself out of the boot, you're buying yourself another 2. So now you're pushing the ball downfield.
And again, accrediting that to, I guess you could only accredit that to a pro-style offense, because Dewey, again, wanted to touch on the fact that he wanted to make Locke more of a mobile quarterback, and that's what you'll get with playing at a pro-style offense. And so that, accredit that to Locke's favor. You know, he kind of had one up coming out of college playing in that pro offense under Dewey. So pretty good stuff there. But yeah, nonetheless, in short, I think it's a bright future for Drew Locke. He's got it on lock, pretty much, as far as the starting position. You're dumb if you go anywhere else. There really shouldn't be any competition. And Elway alluded to that in the offseason presser that they just had a week ago. You know, he's like, that's our guy, and we'd pretty much be stupid to do anything else. So I like where we're going.
I believe his words were, you know, we're not going to release all of our cards, but, you know, it's pretty safe to say he's headed into the offseason as a starter.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. So I guess with that being said, transitioning. Now, there are loopholes in this team. Again, they finished 7-9, and we've got, you know, only 13, 14 free agents, unrestricted free agents, that is, a near $60.3 million in cap space. We wanted to talk about, we're only going to get to a couple of these free agents, maybe even speak on one. I think I know the one you want to speak on. But, you know, what do you do in the case that you have this many free agents? It's almost like shoot, kill. It's like, or kiss, marry, kill, the classic game. It's like basically that. What are you doing with these 13 free agents? Who are you tending to first right out of the gate?
Well, I think you have to prioritize what Vic Fangio wants to run. Mm-hmm. Is he going to be defensive based? Are we going to build around Drew Locke? Are we going to be, you know, a team that control, which is, you know, running the football and just relying on defense? Mm-hmm.
Gotcha. As far as a couple of names, I guess we can go ahead and peek at the list. Justin Simmons, I'll just go ahead and start on him because that's the big elephant in the room. Elway, of course, and Fangio. I might be a couple words off again, but, you know, they were saying, we're going to, you know, we want you around here. We want to keep you here. And I feel like my spidey senses are telling me that they are going to do everything in their power. And if that means they've got to let someone like, I don't know, Chris Harris walk, then you got to do it. Chris Harris didn't have the best of seasons. He finished with a PFF, I want to say last night I was reading, it was his lowest PFF in his 9 seasons with the Broncos. Or he's entering his 9th season. He was drafted in 2011. But
we all know PFF just loved Chris Harris, actually. Yeah. So yeah. That is surprising.
Yeah, he was like 69, I want to say. It could have been lower, but I want to say it was right around the 69 mark. So, I mean, do you even bother to maybe look at Chris Harris, another name, Shelby Harris, or just your focus on Justin Simmons? I mean, what do you do?
From what I understand, I mean, from what I'm told, at least, they actually have prioritized Shelby over Chris. Just based on simple fact of, you know, Shelby's younger. I mean, not by too much, but he is younger and he did have a career year versus, you know, Chris Harris, who did struggle at times. I mean, we're talking about a Chris Harris who, you know, is still playing leagues above most DBs right now.
Yeah.
But he did struggle in Chris Harris terms.
Do you think it has to do with the transitioning into Vic Fangio's system? Because he's been more of a man coverage kind of guy, and with Fangio's system, it's kind of a hybrid mix. It's if I do recall, it's zone. It's very very versatile, as people described it, and it's heavily disguised. So you play with the zone, and you'll get a mix of man. Do you think that has to do with Chris Harris kind of struggling this season?
Absolutely. But, I mean, really, the only thing that's undefeated in life is father time, and Chris Harris isn't getting any younger.
Gotcha. So, I guess the ones you're investing, you're putting your cards all on the Shelby Harris and the Justin Simmons train, which I don't blame you. I mean, those two are very impactful players for this defense. The part of the reason they're keeping, you know, they're keeping stock at the 10th best defense overall, team defense. I mean, you got to put your, you got to invest your money somewhere. And I would say Justin Simmons and Chobe Harris are up there. Agree to care to disagree. I mean,
oh, absolutely. And from what I'm actually understanding is Justin Simmons, it's a foregone conclusion that he's going to be a Denver Bronco in 2020. It's the fact that we're talking about 2021 is really the talking point that they've got to enter the discussion table with, because they will franchise him if they need to. But at this point, we're talking about, you know, a long-term contract signing.
I want to mention a couple of names, a few other names here, names like Corey Nelson, safety Will Parks, Derek Wolfe. Derek Wolfe having a lot of injuries over his career. I don't foresee him being a Bronco in 2020, just for the fact that injuries have gotten to the best of him. But do you think there's any chance that we look at maybe keeping some of those guys around?
I think the worst thing to happen to Derek Wolfe was that injury, because he just dropped into Denver's plans of 2020, where before he was having another great season. I think he was leading the team in sacks at one point, but yeah, he was leading the team in sacks, and then this injury happens, and now we're looking at a guy that's, he was going to make maybe $10 million for three, and now he's looking at 8 for 3, 7 for 3, and it's really struggled. It's been a struggle to find someone that takes that Malik Jackson role.
Yeah.
But we have found that Shelby Harris, he was not happy about playing nose tackle. And once we moved him over to three tech, it was lights out. I mean, he was playing out of his mind. So, yeah, I don't see Derek Wolfe not being on the Broncos team at that point, because now he said he's wanted to be a Bronco for life. And unfortunately, to that injury, he lost himself some money.
And just sort of side note here, I guess we can kind of talk a little bit about this. That front line really was impressive to me, dude. I mean, you had Derek Wolfe in there. Bradley Chubb, of course, got injured early on. It took a few blows. You had Shelby Harris, of course, being an impactful player. Draymond Jones got a few reps. Now, did Draymond, I don't know, and I can't remember to save my life, did DeMarcus Walker and Draymond, or did DeMarcus Walker share? He played outside. Excuse me. Never mind. They would have never played in the same position. But yeah, Draymond Jones stepped up, played really well for Denver. This defensive line was really impressive to me, is what I'm trying to get at. They really stepped up in time of need for Denver.
Especially when they were just thrown together. I mean, you have guys like Mike Purcell just coming out of nowhere. Shelby Harris playing out of position, goes into his natural three-tech position, and led the NFL in passes batted down. Had guys like Draymond Jones that should never have fallen to the third round, I believe.
Yes.
In my opinion, I think I had him as my 47th best player last season. I mean, that was an absolute steal by Elway.
Part of the reason why they were the number one red zone defense is it is because of that defensive front. They were able to get in there and stop the run when necessary, but they were helping to make plays for the secondary, if nothing else. And the front guys, you got to credit them a lot. So transitioning, other names on this list, Corey Nelson, as I referred to before, inside linebacker, and then safety Will Parks. Do you think you see them? Oh, I should mention Casey Crater's also on this list too. yeah, right. Now,
long snappers are not people. Neither are kickers.
Ouch! He was a substitute teacher, wasn't he? Like when they brought him back, I want to say.
I mean, he was a Pro Bowler, but I mean, if we're pinching pennies, I mean, I'm not looking to
Casey
Crater to have an NFL long snapper setting contract here.
Okay, eliminate.
But,
that.
I mean, all if right. we're looking at Will Parks, I mean, I think he was exactly everything that Vic Fangio wanted in his defensive secondary. Mm-hmm. He played the Joker role. He played dime backer. He played dime safety, dime nickel. He played everything you could ever ask him, and he did it with a smile on his face, and he brought the boom. I mean, outside of Jackson, I mean, you were looking at Will Parks to just lay a sucker out.
He's underrated as far as laying the wood. He's a very hard hitter, and that was one of the things when I watched him in his rookie year. Is like when he's in his open field, when you're a receiver, I would not underestimate the power of Will Parks. That man can lay the wood. And Kareem Jackson, you can't say enough about the guy. He played phenomenal this year, especially against his old team, the Houston Texans. Had a hell of a game against them. So,
oh man, if you follow him on Twitter, it's so enjoyable just to see him talk back at all of his former Houston Texan fans. They're asking why he didn't play like that in Texas, and it's great because I mean he's really a cornerback playing strong safety, but I mean he lays the wood like Ward did back in 2015.
Yeah,
it's really a beautiful sight. Yeah, something we haven't had since, you know, who was it? Ward Steve and. Atwater? Yeah, I mean it's been a while since we've had someone just look at a wide receiver and just say screw the fines and I'm just gonna lay you out.
I want to say PFF had him also as a top ranked DB and number two DB. I mean, well, just in the defensive back rankings in 2018, he had like the second highest rating among DBs. Like, he was very underrated in free agents. I mean, I don't know what it was like for everybody else, but I feel like he didn't get a lot of credit, you know, as far as free agency went.
I think it was based on solely everyone was looking at him as a cornerback. And honestly, what Broncos should have done with Champ Bailey was move him to free safety at the end of his career. Broncos moved Jackson over to strong safety, which, I mean, who moves someone at 200 pounds to strong safety? But the guy is killing it in run support. He's killing it on back end. I mean, he can cover tight ends. He's been everything we've been looking for the past, I don't know, 10 years, even past 2015 when Ward was a disaster covering tight ends.
Yeah. No, I agree 100%. I will still say this. I still think you need a little bit of insurance, maybe not in the secondary, but maybe in the linebacking core to help solidify the coverage of the tight end, because I don't think we've seen outside of the bottom 10 in terms of covering the tight end. I know last year for damn sure we could not cover the tight end to save our life, and that's why I was pushing. I was on the Devin Bush train at number 10, but, you know, ironically, we didn't get Devin Bush, but rather the people we traded with got Devin Bush. And, you know, at the end of the season, I was content with Noah Fant. But I'll save that conversation for in a bit. But I want to transition. So we looked inside what our situation is as far as free agency goes. Now we look outside. We've got a little bit of money to spend. Nearly again, $60.3 million in cap.
Right now.
As of right now.
Right now.
As of right now.
Broncos have so many post and pre-June cuts that they've got. They've got guys that they're going to look at immediately, like Justin Simmons. Justin Simmons might be a Bronco for life. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a fun offseason. They've got upwards of $80 million they can play with if they, you know, they play their cards right. They've got 9 draft picks right now, not taking in compensatory picks, which are tradable now.
Yeah, true. That is true. And I know that I read somewhere last night when I was looking at their total draft pick count, I think they had received or were to receive 3 compensatory picks going into the draft. But I don't know if you would label that as pending or if yet to be received. Nonetheless, they still have 9 as it stands, but...
Yeah, the NFL never wants to release their mathematics on how they really give those out. But I think Over the Cap has a pretty good calculator on that. and they've got us with a 5 and a 7, which, okay. I mean, we're looking at, what is that, Danny Trevathan and, you know, a trainable quarterback that can sit behind Drew Lock at this point.
Okay. All right. I mean, that makes sense. Would that be what? 3? You're looking at 3 seventh round picks, I want to say.
Yeah.
And then that would be 2 fifths, or we don't have a fifth. We skip 5th. I might be wrong. I want to say we just have a fourth and then we go into the sixth round, not really having a fifth, because we would have three thirds. Nonetheless, it's a lot of picks. And as of now, of course, as you alluded to, nine picks. So let's go shopping, shall we? Free agency. What are some needs that Denver needs to tend to? They alluded to it a little bit, and you can get into it if you'd like. In their off-season presser, looking ahead, whatever you want to call it, talked about maybe shopping for a cornerback. What do you think Denver tends to as far as their quote-unquote wounds go?
If we're looking at weaknesses, we're definitely looking at offensive line. I mean,
oh, amen.
You've got maybe one guy on that offensive line you feel good about. no, I'm not the biggest Connor McGovern fan. He is serviceable, but Juwan James, as much as I was killed for saying he's above average for when he does play, the guy doesn't play. Yeah. We all know who Garrett Bowles is. I don't really need to touch on that. Super athletic. The guy is just, you know,
he's a hot.
There's a reason why everyone is just holding their breath saying, here we go. It's going to be number 72 every time a flag is called. And then that right hole at right guard. We don't know if it's going to be Wilkinson next year. From what I'm told, it is going to be Wilkinson while they move Juwan James back into his natural right tackle position. Uh-huh. But let's say you've got, you know, your left tackle, which is Garrett Bowles. He did function a little bit better under Drew Lock. You've got Dalton Reisner, who, in my opinion, should have been at least the second team All-Pro. I mean, the guy was lights out outside of what, one unsportsmanlike conduct penalty. I don't even think that was it at this point.
He was the third best player on our offense, in my opinion, this season, I want to say. But keep going. I'm sorry.
Absolutely. I mean, you got Connor McGovern. Dude's going to get paid this summer. I don't understand why. especially when you're working in a zone blocking scheme, when everyone shifts as a unit, you can get away with, having someone who's not, I mean, just like Connor McGovern, you can get away with some guys who have lesser talent, I would say. The only problem you have with zone blocking scheme is when you get into goal line situations that's when you start to see like fullbacks and tight ends come in to add a little bit of muscle and weight, just because zone blocking scheme is usually predicated on, you know, a unit moving together versus forward and trying to move a guy.
Yes.
Then you have, like I said, Wilkinson at right guard, which I think is his natural position. He's, I would say, at least average at right guard. I actually don't mind our guard positions heading into next season. Juwan James, I'm still a fan. I just need to see the guy play, which, I mean, when he played three games, the offense moved. I mean, you can't argue that.
I 100% agree as far as the whole offensive line outlook goes. I think there are some pieces, though. You talk about Wilkinson and then Juwan. I'm all for keeping the pieces that you have if you want to work with it. I mean, if that makes you happy. I mean, hell, you have the arguably one of the best offensive line coaches. You brought him in last year. And, I mean, he took a 31st-ranked Pittsburgh Steelers offensive line before the year, before he even got in, and made them one of the best offensive lines in the NFL, and he brought them up. So as far as that goes, yeah, it might take some time, but I think there are some pieces you can fill void. And Elijah Wilkinson, if you're not we can be satisfied with it, but you don't have to settle for that. I think you've got to take a look. If you go into free agency, at least take a look at Brandon Shreve, because he plays in his own blocking scheme. I mean, he's a vet, the best offensive lineman in this free agency class, arguably. But yeah, what are your thoughts on that?
See, I'm always of the frame of mind, like, let's always get cheaper. I mean, I side more with the, you know, the GM of the team, more outside of the player, just because I'm, like John always said, let's not win for now. Let's win from now on. I always want to win from now on, which means what? Always staying cheap, always staying flexible. And when you're doing that, you're always trying to work with what you're
what you've got, what you've drafted, and the, you know, the little surprises and diamonds in the rough, like, you know, you would see, I don't know, I think Devontae Bosby. We found AJ Johnson. We found Mike Purcell. It's these kind of guys that you really need to start building your team around. And then, unfortunately, you know, the time comes when it comes time to pay them. It's exactly how the New England Patriots have operated over the last 20 years. They found their quarterback. They built around him. They found smart players to play in their system. And then they moved on right before they got pricey.
I will add this. Would you, I know you have the GM mindset. I've learned that. But would you maybe look at, and how many years has it been since you were able to say this, adding Pro Bowl depth behind Ron Leary or, I mean, Juwan James, he could be Pro Bowl caliber.
Leary is gone. I mean, unfortunately, he's just had way too many injuries to keep at this point for, I think his cap number is somewhere around $8 million this year. We're looking at Wilkinson, but honestly, let me throw a name out there for you. How about Marshall Yanda from the Ravens?
Up there
in age. I think he just made another Pro Bowl. I mean, the guy is still playing at a high level. He's not what he was, but you can get him for 2 years. You can get him and then draft his heir apparent this offseason just to back him up. I mean, let's start developing offensive linemen just with Munchak, who we've got in-house.
I was checking out Marshall Yanda to see what he's only allowed one sack this year. That's not too shabby. Zero penalties.
From what I understand, not allowing sacks is pretty good.
Yeah, not allowing sacks is definitely good, especially for Denver. You had a PFF rating of 85.9, so not too bad. I wouldn't mind it. I mean, if you got
it. Although I do wonder how much of those stats are skewed from having Lamar Jackson right behind
you.
Yeah,
being a mobile quarterback, I guess. Yeah, exactly. At 35 years old, as you alluded to, I wouldn't mind taking a look at it.
There was a lot of fans that were really hesitant about bringing on Andrew Whitworth at the time because of his age. I mean, and the guy has shown out since his entire contract with the Rams.
Well, transitioning from the offensive line talk, going over to another position that I've heard will potentially actually, I think, will be a point of emphasis in free agency. Talk about the cornerback position. Of course, we alluded to Chris Harris departing potentially, and now it's we're foreseeing it as possibly likely. Some names that you kind of find to fit Vic Fangio's schematics next season, maybe Denver brings in, takes a look at. Who are some names that interest you?
I mean, right now, if we're looking at the roster, I mean, your number one cornerback that you would trust is who? Devontae Bosby, who is coming off a neck injury, which was pretty scary. But before that, I mean, the guy was lights out. I mean, I'm not sure how Kansas City let him get out of their building at the time.
Pitt State product. He's right down the road from where I'm from, Joplin, Missouri. It's a 20-minute drive. So I know a little bit about him. Great guy. Great football player, but anyway.
It's not exactly the best cornerback class as far as free agency. You're looking at, like, Ronald Darby. And then Byron Jones, who just switched over from free safety to cornerback, who, I mean, everyone has loved him since switching over to cornerback. Honestly, I haven't paid much attention to him because, honestly, I thought he was still a free safety. Last time I heard from him, he was breaking the high jump record over at the combine until, you know, a little guy named Justin Simmons came through.
Shout out. No, I was reading about Byron Jones, and he had in 2018, he had the fourth highest grade. I just love Pro Football Focus for some reason. But anyway, he had the fourth highest graded coverage. He was the fourth highest graded coverage corner. According to PFF, he allowed 0.7 yards per snap in man coverage. I don't know how that looks with Fangio's system, with it being a hybrid. What they were saying was it's beyond us why you would let a guy that was so good or so productive, especially in the man coverage situations, walk. But all things considered, Dallas does have Dak Prescott to worry about and Amari Cooper and a few other free agent names that they will have to tend to. So this could be the risk for Dallas this offseason.
Yeah, they also have Chidobe Awuzie, I believe.
Colorado product.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, he was showing out pretty well over in Cowboy Land. But yeah, I'm not sure how you can let someone like Byron Jones leave your building. I honestly, man-to-man cornerback is not exactly the easiest thing to find in the NFL anymore. I mean, we're talking about maybe 10 guys in the NFL that you would trust on the outside these days.
Yeah. One of those names you talk about outside being an A corner, Kendall Fuller was another name that was brought up out of Kansas City, second highest PFF grade among corners in 2017. Played great for the Chiefs. As much as it pains for me to say it, he had a PFF grade of 60.5 this season, not his best, but nonetheless, he was playing really well out wide, was some of what his analysis said.
Was he acquired in that whole... He was traded from Chicago, I believe.
Yes, he was traded from Chicago.
Was Fangio coaching him at the time? Because that might be something that... I mean, we've seen old coaches bring in guys like... I mean, he brought in Callahan right from Chicago. I mean, it would have worked out perfectly, but, I mean, unfortunately, Callahan got hurt.
Well,
that could be another connection.
I was going to say that makes sense because when he's played at the outside corner, he's allowed a passer rating of 42.9 over the duration of his career. And he could play in man. They were saying that he could play in man, but he can also play out wide. He's very versatile. So, I mean, that makes sense as far as Fangio, if he were to play in Fangio's system. I want to see if Fangio did coach Fuller up in his time with Chicago, but you bring up a good point in bringing him back in.
Yeah, I mean, reunite him with Callahan. I mean, you could have... I mean, if we're looking at next year, I mean, Broncos are about to get two free agents just right off the bat. You're looking at Callahan, you're looking at Chubb. And, I mean, for lack of better terms, we're also looking at Juwan James. So, I mean, you're getting an all-pro talented caliber outside linebacker. You're getting one of the best nickel cornerbacks outside of Chris Harris. And as much as people hate to hear it, you're getting one hell of a right tackle. I mean, Broncos are really set up with guys already on their roster. Mm-hmm. And 2020 looks really nice as far as this offseason goes, because we haven't even scratched the surface and they're already getting three guys back.
He was, he was traded from Washington. And that was the Alex Smith exchange, I do believe, was one of the, one of the products that they sent over, and then it might have been pick compensation. But yeah, it was in fact with Washington. But I want to say, I'm certain you got that confused with another four, and I'm trying to think of their name, and I just can't think of their name
right
now.
I am sure I am. I have not done that yet. I've been pretty good about separating those two, but of course it would come on now, right?
It's all right. Hey, it's all right.
Kyle, I believe it's Kyle.
That's it. There we go. We're good. Saved it. No. Transitioning. So we go to another position. Do you think Denver, and I know you're I've seen your Twitter, actually right now is a good time. You can follow Alex at @V_Broncos. You can find him on Twitter, and then me at @KeeganHartman1. I know it's a fancy name. It didn't take too much thought. Anyway, we go into wide receivers. A couple names, of course, Amari Cooper hitting the market, AJ Green hitting the market. Robbie Anderson has been a name that's been attached to Denver. Where do you think Denver shops for a receiver this time in free agency?
I really don't. I mean, I think they're pretty happy with Patrick and Sutton, who I'm sure is ecstatic for getting that second team All-Pro. I mean, I'm sorry, should have gotten second team All-Pro. We're talking about Justin Simmons. This dude is a monster. We're looking at the Mike Evans of this, of the past 5 years, maybe at least. Exactly. I mean, who is the biggest guy outside of Mike Evans? Was it Vincent Jackson, who used to play with San Diego? The guy just, he's insane. I mean, doesn't matter if it's his hands, if he's getting separation, if he's boxing out guys. Wide receiver one and wide receiver two, I think Broncos are pretty happy with what they've got with Patrick and Sutton. Now we're looking at field stretching guys. We're looking at slot guys.
Gotcha.
We don't really need to look at slot guys. I mean, Hamilton really came on toward the end of the season with Locke. And then you've got Fant, who is a glorified slot wide receiver.
No.
But now we are looking for field stretchers. And that's when guys like Ruggs come into consideration.
And I, you know, I actually got to see a little bit of Henry Ruggs last night. I analyzed a little bit of his tape, and I like what I saw from the kid. But I'm gonna get into him in a minute. But yeah, I don't think Denver really has to go wide receiver. You bring up a good point. All of that, if nothing else, it's getting tended to in the draft. I think Denver takes a look at it in the draft. The Benjamin Albright, I think he reported that, you know, if a certain somebody, Ruggs, is at 15, then they might take a look at selecting him. But you really don't have to tend to it in free agency, given what's out there.
Yeah, I believe he said put it in pen or something like that. Yeah, he's not. I don't believe they're really going to let him pass him. I mean, if we're talking about, you know, I've made the comparison from CeeDee Lamb, who has very Hopkins-like abilities.
We're talking
about Henry Ruggs, who's got that heel speed. And then we're talking about Chenault, who's, happens every single time I think of the guy. Percy Harvin. We're talking about Percy Harvin kind of abilities. As soon as he gets the football, we're talking about a running back in the open field. So really, Broncos, at this point, I would say they're either looking at offensive linemen or they're looking at toys for Drew Lock at this point in the draft.
Real quick, before we get into a little bit of our draft talk to kind of close out the show, do you think that, you know, I guess this kind of eliminates it, but in case something were to happen, do you think Denver could take a look at defensive tackles in free agency, specifically maybe a name like Chris Jones from Kansas City?
Not with the Shelby Harris love that they've been throwing around. And plus, we're looking at, Chris Jones is just going to get paid. If you look at Michael Brocker's old and Fletcher Cox's old contract, I mean, they just broke the bank. He won't break the bank like that because it was 1 year or it's been a couple of years, but he's going to get paid. You can get Shelby or who is it? Chris Jones light in Shelby Harris. But honestly, I mean, I think they are pretty happy with Draymond Jones right now. But they are about to lose Adam Gotsis. Derek Wolfe is a free agent. And then you're looking at Shelby Harris. So, yeah, that entire defensive line is under construction right now. So you should be looking at free agency as far as defensive line.
I believe I was one of those ones that kind of laughed at Kansas City whenever they took Chris Jones out of Mississippi State in the first round. I was like, I think they had some other needs and it had to do with their offensive line, but I could be wrong on what they had to tend to, but they went defense, and clearly I'm not a GM for a reason, because that guy has done a lot of damage for that defensive front, and he's been productive for the Kansas City Chiefs, and everybody wants to be, I mean, that needs a defensive tackle. Chris Jones is a pretty good suit. He's with great company as far as defensive tackles that have played in this league. He's among the elite. So I owe an apology to Chris Jones if he were to ever find this podcast. So, but
I think with Vangio's system, you can get away with a little bit of a mush rush kind of pressure on the quarterback, just because he does mix so many things up on the back end. And I think that will be the focus as far as secondary goes. So you can't get away with, a Draymond Jones, Mike Purcell, and then player to be named later, free agent who, you know, we've seen Elway pull these kind of free agents out of nowhere. Recently, he's been taking a lot of guys who were injured, Callahan, Juwan James included. But we're talking about John Elway, who was at the point where he was just finding gems just left and right. And I think that is something that he can continue.
Well, if he keeps with his thrift shopping ways, if you will, do you think he could, I know somebody had alluded to, and I didn't really quite understand it. So maybe you could put it into perspective for me, make it make sense for me. They had talked about, I watched a video, and I don't know what it's called when a person has a dead contract, or they can just, I couldn't explain it. They were coming off injury. Akeem Hicks was one of these people, and I could not think of the term for it, but they were able to maybe pick up the contract or buy out the contract. I don't know. I know that they were able to get these, there was a certain term for it. I can't think of it, but never mind. Scratch that. I have no idea where I was going there. But anyway, all right. We'll come back to that. I'll look forward to my research.
It does sound like something that Alway could find himself into. I mean, right now, I mean, they just picked up, I believe, 15 futures contracts. And yes, we're looking at guys like, you know, Patrick and Shelby Harris, who mm-hmm. was, you know, a product of that. And I mean, those guys have obviously worked out great for Denver. So, I mean, what I love about the Broncos is they don't care if you were taken in the first round or in the 15th round, which, yes, I'm aware it's not real, but we're talking about a Broncos team that will just really just play whoever earns the spot. And whether that's good or bad, where if you believe that, hey, Drew Lock earned that spot or should have been playing this entire time, he didn't earn it according to the Broncos, and didn't outplay, Brandon Allen at the time, or who was it? Hogan at the time in preseason. They're going to put the best player who exemplifies exactly what they're looking for in practice. So it doesn't matter if you're first round or undrafted free agent. Hello, Chris Harris. It doesn't matter. They're going to put the best guy in the field, which, I mean, if we're talking about who are we talking about? Bill Kolar, who honestly stood on the table for Adam Gotsis, which he probably shouldn't have because that has been a not great pick. But we're talking about Bill Kolar, who's developed Derek Wolfe, Malik Jackson, now Draymond Jones. He's worked with the likes of J.J. Watt. I mean, the guy has just been phenomenal. I'm surprised they were able to keep him. So where others are like, you know, let's go spend big money on a defensive lineman, I'm sitting here thinking, well, whatever happened to developing guys?
I mean, I didn't know that Kohler had connections with J.J. I guess I never really realized that he had a connection with the development of J.J. Watt. But, I mean, if you can develop that monster, or you could be around that, then that's going to help you in the future. And I can definitely see that what he's been able to do, Gotsis being the caveat to that conversation. But, you know, you talk about Draymond Jones, Derek Wolfe. I mean, developing those guys, he's done a good job, so I kind of agree with you as far as with what you got. Just develop those guys into key components of your defensive line. So I kind of like that approach. I really do.
Yeah, speaking on free agency, my GM hat on, I'll always put, like, you know, a proven vet who will fill a hole immediately, who knows exactly what the coach is looking for, can step mm-hmm. into a similar scheme at all times. And then get a guy that's right behind him. The vet knows exactly what's going to happen. I mean, he knows he's here for either a year or two, and then he's out while a guy develops behind him.
Gotcha. That makes perfect sense. So lastly, transitioning from the free agency talk, our very back end of the show here to close out our very first episode of Broncos Brawl podcast. And I think we're going to make this an episode thing over the next few episodes, since, you know, Denver has so many picks, and we're going to wait for these compensatory picks to kind of fall into place. That's why we're doing this sort of by an episode at a time, but we're going to start with the first round of the 2020 NFL draft. Got a lot of talent coming out of here, especially the cream de la crop, if you will, of this draft class. Last year, it was the defensive line. This year, it's the wide receivers. Denver. Let's talk Denver. First round, 15th pick. That's what they hold. Who do you think Denver selects with that 15th pick?
Well, I can tell you one thing. It's not going to be on defense. You can put mine in pencil, not in pen. But it's not going to be on defense, especially with a guy like Vic Fangio at the head. I mean, we're talking about a guy who's, you know, has developed so many just priceless guys like a Bosby, an Alexander Johnson, a Purcell. They're going to go for once. I mean, outside of Paxton Lynch and who is it? Noah Fant. Yeah. They're going to go on offense. We're talking about maybe a toy for Drew Lock, which, I mean, who would argue that? I mean, the guy can push the ball downfield like Patrick Mahomes. Mm-hmm. Or are we going to buy time for a Drew Lock with a worked over offensive line?
We need it. If we can tend to our wounds in free agency, bring in bits and pieces to help develop, I like the whole development aspect and the development approach. If you can do that in free agency, just bring in those little bits and pieces, products like Marshall Yanda, then that really alleviates what you need to do with that 15th pick. And I think that they go toy in the first round. You can show me the toys that you got first, and then I'll show you what I got in my basket. But I'll let you tell the people what you went shopping for Denver if you're John Elway.
I mean, as far as, like you alluded to, it is a great draft for wide receivers. Not a good draft, a great draft. I mean, it's at least 15 deep of guys who could, there either are wide receiver ones or can develop into wide receiver ones. So with that being said, I would, if we're talking about toys, I'll get to the offensive line in a sec. If we're talking about toys, we're looking at a CD Lamb who should or could be there, depending on, you know, what Oakland likes to do. We know they like speedy, gigantic wide receivers. Or we're talking about a guy like from my beloved Alabama Crimson Tide, Henry Ruggs, who is a do-it-all kind of guy who really can just stretch the entire field, which, I mean, now you're pulling safeties off trying to cover him. You're pulling safeties off of Sutton, which if Sutton's going to be one-on-one, I'll take my chances with that. Sutton's already going to have a cornerback one. So now you're doubling up. You're bringing guys off of Sutton. You're dragging them downfield with Ruggs, and now you've got a Patrick wide open on the right side. Yep. I think it's a great pick if you're looking at Henry Ruggs, just based on speed. But, I mean, this draft has do-it-all players. I mean, you can find a guy who has Sutton type of size in the second round with, who is it, Pittman out of USC.
Yeah.
You can find a guy like, I think his name escapes me, Hamlin from Penn State, who is probably going to run right around a sub-4. The guy can field stretch. But honestly, everyone wants to go wide receiver, and I don't know if I'm feeling it, man. I'm looking more towards our 27th rushing or offensive line. I'm looking more towards an embarrassing left tackle. I'm looking more towards a free agent average center. A question mark at right guard and a hurt right tackle. So honestly, if I'm looking at first round, I'm looking at and hoping and praying that Tristan Wirfs is there.
Yeah, I agree 100%. I think Tristan Wirfs, when you watch his film, not only would he reunite with his teammate Noah Fant when they played at Iowa, but I watched Tristan Wirfs, and I think he's one of the most aggressive guys, if not the most aggressive, and he's very underrated because everybody's been paying attention to these SEC offensive linemen, Andrew Thomas out of Georgia. I didn't like Andrew Thomas. I wasn't impressed with his aggression. Like, there was no aggression there. You watch Tristan Wirfs, and I mean, he just gets off. He comes at you. He's a scrapper. You know, I really like – I like he's not Garrett Bowles hot-headed, but he plays with the fire, and that's what I like about Tristan. And if he's at 15, then Denver's got to make a move because a lot of these guys are projecting Wirfs to be gone within the first 10 picks. But you know, I think if he falls past 10, John Elway, you gotta pull what you did with Garrett Bowles. Find a trade partner. Get up there and get your guy. I think he can come in and make a day one impact.
Yeah, even if you've got to sit him behind Garrett Bowles until, like I said, the Broncos make him earn it. I mean, I think it'd be a great pick.
I think, you know, you alluded to the second round. If you focus on what you need here, you know, everybody going receiver, you bring up an excellent point with that. Everybody's going receiver in this first round because it's just so receiver heavy. And then you want to resort in the second round. Second round, I look at receivers like Justin Jefferson, which was projected in the third for Denver, but I just like how he's been. I mean, of course, he's got Joe Burrow, Heisman Trophy winner, but out of LSU, 6'3", he's the second tallest receiver in this draft class.
Doesn't hurt.
You what?
Yeah, it doesn't hurt.
Yeah, it doesn't hurt at all. He had over 1,400 yards, 18 touchdowns. I mean, yes, Joe Burrow, again, he's on there. But it's you got to think, it's a big receiving core that he's got. He's got a plethora of weapons. And Justin Jefferson has come in. He was a two-star recruit. Stars don't matter. This is a story to prove it. I watched his route running last night, and, man, he's just crisp. He reminds me, when he gets in between the hashes, he reminds me of Demaryius Thomas. Because if you put it in the right spot, he leads with his eyes. And he's very good with the fundamentals. He's very good at deceiving defensive backs with his eyes. You know, his footwork is really good. And he just runs really tight routes. And I think that he could be a potential Demaryius Thomas, especially when you're talking open field plays. Juwan Winfrey was one of those guys that I thought could be one of those people too, and I think he could still work into that. But yeah, Justin Jefferson is a playmaker, and I think if you can snag him with your second round pick, that's an A for me. I think if you get Tristan Wirfs and Justin Jefferson in your first two picks, you did a good job, Denver.
Yeah, absolutely. I have nothing to add to that.
Well, I think we've touched on just about everything that we've needed to this podcast episode. Man, it just feels so good to actually, you know, discuss this. It's kind of like a therapy session, just getting everything out and, you know, unleashing as we transition into 2020. And I, you know what, for me, you know, you go back to the presser with John Elway, and I'm like, he said playoffs, that's the expectation. Damn it, it is playoffs. You're right, because especially being around here with a bunch of Kansas City Chiefs fans, they're like, oh, they still got a lot to prove. You know, you got all shut up. I think Denver is in a position right now where we could be seeing. And again, my dad, he's a big fanatic of Denver. He said, you know, you go back to the 1990s. He said, this is going to be the same hype around it as Joe Montana and John Elway had in the early 90s. Like, this is what we could be seeing with Patrick Mahomes and Drew Lock next year. I definitely see that potential. And I agree with him. I watched old highlights of Joe Montana and John Elway, and damn, it was a shootout.
I mean, if we're not only talking about Drew Lock and Mahomes, we're also talking about an Oakland team that's going to be maybe possibly searching for another quarterback. And same with San Diego. There's rumors around there floating around that either Rivers is gone or he's retiring. So, I mean, we could look at almost four brand new young quarterbacks coming into the AFC West.
What if Tom Brady comes to LA?
I welcome it. I welcome it. The guy is a shell of himself.
Yep. That'll be our secondary. It'll be top five.
Yes, please bring that on, please.
Well, that's going to do it for Alex Valdez. Man, you got anything to say for these guys before we close out?
No, I'm happy to start this journey with you guys. It's going to be one hell of an offseason. It's super exciting. Damn near $70+ million to play with, all this free agency to go, and then we've still got the draft, who we haven't even scratched the surface on. I'm excited.
I am so excited to get this offseason started, and I'm fortunate enough to say that I will be at this year's draft in Las Vegas, so hopefully we can get a show in around that time. Oh, nice. And maybe do a live show from there. But excited for this offseason. Thank you guys for listening. This has been Broncos Brawl. Thank you once more. Have a phenomenal day, everybody.